Hi, it's Jeff Scheuer from Mattress to Go. Today I wanted to talk a little bit about foams. Now there are three different types of foams that are really commonly used in the mattress industry. Polyurethane foam, viscoelastic memory foam, and latex foam. But before I describe the differences between those foams, let's go over two terms that are used to describe the characteristics of these foams. The first you may have heard is density. And density is simply the weight of a 1 cubic foot piece of that foam. Pretty simple concept. The second term, which you may not have heard as often, is called the I.F.D, or the Indentation Force Deflection Number, and this refers to the softness of the foam. The industry will take a 15-inch by 15-inch by 4-inch thick piece of that foam, and they'll measure the amount of weight required to compress it 25%, or down to 3 inches. The higher the number, the more weight that was used, the harder the foam. Now, a foam that's very dense, very heavy, can have a high or a low I.F.D number. It can be hard or soft. And the same is true of a low density or a very lightweight foam. It can be hard or soft. So the density number is not an indicator necessarily of the quality or the softness or the firmness of the foam. You want to pay attention to that IFD number. Now the first foam I'd like to talk about is polyurethane foam. Polyurethane foam is by far the most common type of foam that we use in the industry for cushioning and for comfort. Polyurethane foam is open cell in construction, meaning that it's very breathable. It's a polyol plus an isocyanate plus water mixed together. That's in its purest form. That's polyurethane foam. And how it's produced mostly in our industry is what's called slab stock construction. They'll mix these chemicals together very vigorously and pour them onto a moving conveyor belt. And as the foam goes along this conveyor belt, it has sides so you know the foam, the mixture doesn't spill over, but it immediately starts to react, and within a few hundred feet, within just 2 to 3 minutes, the foam will be 2 to 4 feet in thickness. Actually, we've got a really good video of that on our Mat2Go website page. If you go into the Beducation section, it's really neat to watch this process take place. Once the foam reaches the end of that conveyor belt, they'll slice it into slabs, you know, hence the slab stock name, and allow it to cure for a few days, and then cut it into the different shapes and thicknesses depending upon the vendor's order. Now, you can change the way the foam feels by introducing blowing agents like CO2, surfactants, different catalysts. You can change the percentage of the chemical mixture. All these things are done to influence the softness, the density, the quality. You know, we have cheap foams out there as well as expensive foams. And sometimes when you go with a real thick piece of foam, they may cut it into a special shape or a convoluted foam. Some people call it egg crate foam. This is really common with polyurethane foams, and this is done by just taking a thicker piece of foam and using a special tool, cutting it into the special shapes. Now, if there's a very complex shape that the vendor is ordering, they may actually have a mold, and they'll pour that liquid mixture into it and allow the foam to form directly in that mold, something that's too complex for a machine to cut. The next type of foam I'd like to talk about is viscoelastic memory foam. Now, we're all pretty familiar with this. We've seen the infomercials on television. This is basically a specialized type of polyurethane foam that is slow recovery. When a weight is applied to it, it slowly wraps up around that weight. It's a what we call a semi-closed cell foam in the industry. It's mostly open cell in construction, but there are some closed cells on the inside, and the cell structure is usually quite small. So it's not as breathable as a true polyurethane foam. This was a result in the 1960s of the NASA AMES Research and Technology Transfer Program. It was originally developed to cushion astronauts from the really violent forces on takeoff and landing of the spacecraft. So it's excellent at cushioning and motion deadening. It's also used quite a bit in hospitals for burn patients or people who are very sensitive to pressure points. Now, while it's great at slow recovery and motion deadening, it does have a few unique characteristics. Even the newer types of this foam are still very temperature sensitive, and they do trap heat. So the warmer the foam gets, it gives at a bit of a faster rate. Also, it's subject to the ambient temperature in the room. If you keep your bedroom cool, like most of us are supposed to do when we sleep, the foam will feel a bit harder when you initially get into your mattress. And if the humidity is higher in your home, the foam will also feel softer. So again, viscoelastic memory foam is a specialized type of polyurethane foam. It has some very unique characteristics. Basically, it's slow in recovery. It's very good at pressure point resistance, but it does also have a few unique characteristics with sensitivity to temperatures. The last type of foam I'd like to talk about is latex, or vulcanized rubber foam, and this has been in our industry for quite a while. Latex is open cell in construction, very breathable, and in its purest sense, it's a mixture of the sap from a rubber tree combined with water. Now, you'll add different agents, curing agents, maybe some man-made latex to help resist tearing and increase resiliency and resistance to body impressions, but really it's a pretty simple product. There are two ways to produce latex foam. The older, more traditional way is called Dunlop style, and that's sort of like making a cake. You'll pour the mixture into a mold, let it rise, cure, and then you'll slice it into pieces. And that's really common for making a thicker piece, like the core of a mattress, the support core. The more modern type of latex foam, and the one that we actually tend to lean towards, is called Talalay style latex, and this is a vacuum mold formed latex. They'll pour the mixture into an aluminum form with these pinhole cores, and that mold will shut. They'll immediately extract the air, the liquid mixture will expand, and all the particulate will be flash frozen, so the particulate doesn't settle in the bottom. Then the coolant is generally heated, and the foam on the inside cures. And it's a very consistent way to make the foam, also something that can be controlled by computers, so you get a very accurate level of comfort with the foam. And again, you'll find the latex foam can be made into thick pieces for a foam core, or thinner pieces which will be placed on top of the inner spring unit more for a cushioning or for a comfort layer. Latex foam doesn't support bacterial growth. It's inherently antimicrobial, and as I said before, it's very breathable, not sensitive to temperature. So it's a bit of a different animal from the specialty memory foam, whereas it does provide instant support and contour to your body, but not sensitive to the temperature differences in ambient temperature or your body. We're commonly asked, what really is the difference between the two types of specialty foams that are common out there, the viscoelastic memory foam and the latex foam? And we came up with what I think is a really unique demonstration that shows the characteristics of each product. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to drop a weight onto each different type of piece of foam. So let's take the memory foam first. I'll take basically, this is a box spring demonstration unit. And I'm going to drop this on the foam and we'll see how the foam reacts to the weight being applied. You can see how the foam immediately deadens the weight being dropped onto it, and then it slowly sinks a little bit, and along the sides it wraps up around the material, again that slow recovery feature of the foam. And then it will eventually reach a resting state, and that's where it's going to stay. Now once we remove the weight from the foam, you'll see it slowly returns to its original shape, hence the term, you know, slow recovery memory foam. Now let's take a piece of the latex foam and see how that reacts when we drop the same weight on top of it. Put that up on top. You can see how the latex foam doesn't deaden the motion as much as the memory foam. It bounces up, it's supporting because it's vulcanized rubber, and then it reaches a state and that's it. It contours to the outside, but not as much as the memory foam. If we remove the weight, it pops up immediately to its original state, a bit more of a supportive material. Another way we can demonstrate this is just dropping the foam. If I drop the foam on top of the table, you can see it's a pretty dead feel with the memory foam. If I drop the latex foam, it bounces like a ball. So there you have it, the difference in characteristics between viscoelastic foam and latex foam.